Jeremy, on behalf of Australians for Reconciliation in Syria, I'm very delighted to welcome you and to interview you. Australians for Reconciliation in Syria, AMRIS, has a lot of support. We support peace and reconciliation in Syria, but our network of activists, diehard activists, is a small team, as you see here, but we've got a big voice, hopefully, and so we're very glad to have you here. Mm-hmm. Questions about Syria. Australia's been involved in wars in the Middle East for many, many years, over a century, and we've been able to send our soldiers to the Middle East without too much worry about what they're doing there, without much concern for the local populations or the societies there, just some concern for our soldiers. There's a war in Syria now. Do you think that it's changing, the wars in the Middle East are changing, and we should be concerned not just for soldiers but for those societies and for our own society?
Well, first of all, there have been wars in the Middle East recently in modern history since the beginning of the 19th century. And the template for 19th century into the 20th century up until fairly recently was that you told someone to do something and they didn't do what you wanted, and so you sent out the gunboats, right, and fired away, then you landed your army, and depending on what you wanted, you took the country over. That happened all across the Middle East. It happened to Algeria, it happened to Egypt, it happened to many, many countries, it happened to Syria after the First World War. You just kind of hit people, punished them, and took what you wanted.
This is basically the West you're talking about.
This is the West, the Western armies, that's what they did, you know, and they just kind of rolled over the opposition, and generally speaking, the technology was always superior. And that's the why they were able to win these wars, because numerically they could have been overwhelmed, but they always had bigger guns and, you know, more sophisticated weaponry. And that, if we look at recent wars like the war in Iraq in 1991, the air war after Saddam Hussein went into Kuwait, the Americans just attacked. This was an air war, fundamentally an air war in 1991. They filleted the country. Like a fish with the backbone missing. So Iraq was left flopping around, absolutely hopeless, with its whole infrastructure, you know, destroyed. And this was a concept which was, had been developed by the Americans. It was called the, more or less the it's a total war against the system, against the system. And so it's not the army that you want to destroy, you want to destroy the system, because without the system, the army can't operate. There's no transport, there's no bridges, there's no sewage, there's no electricity. And that's what the Americans did. They kind of just completely, as I said, filtered Iraq in that war. So when we go to the war of 1991, the similarities are with the past, in the sense of in the 19th century they introduced new weaponry and weren't really quite sure what effect these weapons were going to have. Look at the British off Alexandria in 1882. The fleet had reinforced steel plating, it had new weaponry. For the first time in warfare, they'd introduced hydraulic gun platforms. So instead of the whole ship having to turn around to fire at a target, you only had to turn the gun. And so the people in London were very excited about this. So how is this all going to work? And they were delighted, because basically they blew the shoreline of Alexandria to bits. You know. And then we see in the war in 1991, the air war, the smart bombs. Remember all the talk on the media about these new weapons, the new generation of weapons the Americans had introduced, and bombs that didn't have to be told what to do. They knew where to go, more or less, and they created havoc. But of course, a lot of it was propaganda, because most of the bombs they used were old-fashioned bombs, the kind of bombs they'd used since the Korean War, old-fashioned iron bombs. They weren't smart at all. They were just dropped and created tremendous destruction over a certain kind of area.
And civilians were killed.
Oh, of course. In all of these wars, civilians are killed. If you look at 1882, when the British bombed Alexandria, which was one of the finest cities of the Mediterranean, and destroyed much of the shoreline, and set fire to buildings and so forth and so on, and the local people were, you know, obviously outraged. And then the British kind of had to land troops to restore order, which they'd just destroyed. And that was the kind of arguments the Americans were putting out in Iran, were here to restore order to the oil ministry. You know, the only building that they guarded in Baghdad after they went into Iraq later on was the oil ministry. But anyway, 1991, it was the same kind of thing with technology, you know. Anyway, so that particular war was, in its own way, was similar to 19th century wars, but that was then followed by a decade of sanctions, which is a different kind of war, and was even more destructive than the air war, much, much more destructive. I mean, a huge number of people died, you know.
Particularly children.
Particularly children, 500,000 children. And children under the age of 5 were just dying like flies because there's no medicine, there wasn't this, there wasn't that. And that war was nominally maintained by the UN, UN Security Council, you know, but actually maintained by Britain and the US. I mean, most other countries that had kind of committed themselves to sanctions, you know, within 7 or 8 years had lost interest because they were so destructive. And the two UN humanitarian coordinators, Dennis Halliday and Hans von Swanick, both described them as these sanctions as genocidal, right? So after the air war of 1991, then a decade of sanctions, Iraq was just wrecked.
So we had two UN officials that spoke out.
Yes, of course.
Does that happen today?
No, they both did. Mm-hmm. And definitely Dennis Halliday used the word genocide, and I'm pretty sure that Hans von Spanik did as well. And Halliday resigned because he couldn't stomach what he was watching, what he had to watch. And those sanctions were maintained by Britain and the US mm-hmm. at the UN. They maintained them, right? And then, of course, we get 2003, and the decision to kind of launch another attack on Iraq, you know, the weapons of mass destruction. Once again, it's complete propaganda and tremendous kind of platform of lies. And they go in and they destroy Iraq as a unitary country. And kind of the first wave of attack is pretty quick. They overwhelm the country, and then, you know, the country disintegrates, and the Americans are there trying to cope with the consequences of what they've done. So these are all different kinds of war. Now, when we come to Libya, okay, that's kind of a war very much in the Palmerston tradition. Send out the gunboats. But you don't send out the gunboats anymore. You send in the F-16s or F-15s, whatever they are. Right? So they decided to destroy Libya. And they went to the UN, and the UN gave them the fig leaf, you know, the no-fly zone was supposed to protect the civilian population, which was turned into a 7-month aerial bombing campaign against Libya, which killed God knows how many people. All right, so that was kind of similar to the 19th century as well, a kind of a hit, a king hit, against a country that actually had no possibility of defending itself against the Americans. So then we turn to Syria. So how is the Syria war different? They wanted to do the same thing to Syria. Okay, they went to the UN, they tried to get their resolution for a no-fly zone, which would have led to the most destructive air war. And the UN said no. Well, it wasn't the UN that said no. It was actually Russia and China. They blocked that resolution going through. So, all right, we can't get our air war. So next best thing is to pull down the government of Damascus by using armed gangs, mercenaries. Okay? And that's what they did and what they've done from that time up to the present. You know, this is a very, very long war. It's now gone on longer than, I think, the Second World War. This campaign since 2011 until now.
Yeah, March 2011.
And they still haven't succeeded in reaching their main objective, which is the destruction of the government in Damascus. All they have done is set in motion the destruction of a large part of Syria. All right? So that's the main difference. You know, they weren't able to fight the kind of war they wanted, which is straightforward bombing destruction, because they were blocked, and so they picked up this other option of working through armed gangs. And many of these people they're using are really no different from the Contras that were used in Nicaragua against the Sandinistas. It's a template here.
Why do these people choose to fight the local government? Why do they choose to align with Western governments when they can see, as clearly as you and I can see, that these Western governments are out to destroy
Arab But which
Arab
people are we
societies?
Talking about? We don't know who these people are. We know that in the first place some of them were Syrians, a lot of them, even from the beginning, they were coming into Syria from Iraq. Because the Syria war is in many ways, is the Iraq war exported. The Saudis and other Gulf states have pumped money into Sunni Muslim groups in Western Iraq to destabilise the government in Baghdad, which they didn't like because it was Shia dominated. All right, so there's a link between what happened in Iraq, obviously, and what happened in Syria. All right, and so the whole thing in Syria was wildly overstated. We know there was a protest movement in the first place. All right, people protest all the time. They don't like a government, they don't like the economic conditions, they don't like all kinds of things. And what you do if you want to destroy that government is you wait for the moment. And we've seen this happen in Latin America and the Middle East, you know, over many, 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 many decades. Happened in Chile, happened in many other Latin American countries. It happened in Ukraine, right? It happened in Iran in 1953. And then when the people begin to protest, you come in behind and you turn those protests to your own advantage. So when you talk of why do people support them, we don't know what level of true support there was. You know, this is not a civil war. This is a campaign against Syria orchestrated by outside governments that want to destroy Syria and are using a protest movement, right, infiltrating it, You might remember the first week of that protest movement in Dara, in southern Syria, and we were told that the Syrian military was just firing into peaceful protesters, and what the media didn't report was the number of civilians and police who were killed by armed men in that week. And we were told by the same media that there were snipers on rooftops firing into peaceful demonstrators. They said government snipers, almost certainly they weren't. They were provocateurs, stirring up as much trouble as they could. And since those days, we know full well that the number of foreigners coming to Syria has turned into a flood.
Jeremy, the thing you mentioned about snipers, mm-hmm. I was in Damascus in mm-hmm. April 2011, mm-hmm. which was just 1 month after the start of the crisis, and I met a young man that had been to an anti-government rally just mm-hmm. that morning, and he said that two people were killed at the rally, mm-hmm. And others were shot. There were police at the rally mm-hmm. with arms, but they did not draw their weapons.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So it was just a mystery who killed these people.
Right.
And Syrians know this.
But well, this is part of a template, mm-hmm. right? This happens in many situations like this, where you send your undercover agents into a situation. They open fire from a rooftop or from behind a corner. No one really knows who does it, but that's the opportunity that the enemy wants and its media wants to portray the government as being brutal, repressive, and killing its own people. And so what we're seeing in Syria is just a repeat of what we've seen in many, many other countries. We had this in Istanbul, in Taksim Square in 1977. There was May Day March, and people started firing into the crowd. And they were obviously agents provocateurs. Turning the whole demonstration, disrupting it, turning it into a kind of a panic-stricken kind of riot. Yes, because people didn't know what was going on. Yeah.
One thing that few people know is that there was a CIA orchestrated coup in Syria in 1949.
Mm-hmm.
The first CIA coup ever, because mm-hmm. the CIA mm-hmm. had just been recently set up.
Mm-hmm.
This was in Syria, and so Syrian people know their history, know their enemies.
Well, the whole thing is that people in the Arab world, generally speaking, have a very strong grasp of history.
Mm-hmm.
And, the people who suffer, who are the victims, they always remember the history. The people who do bad things to them, they want to move on, want to forget it. So of course Syrians know the history, and it's not just 1949, this goes back mm-hmm. to the end of the First World War. When Syria has been under siege effectively all that time up to the present day. So in 1949, yes, that coup, Husni Zaim, was put there by the CIA. And then he was followed by the second man, Sami Hanawi. Then Adib Shishakli. And Shishakli, whether he was actually put up to it by the Americans is not clear, but probably he wasn't. But what he did, the Americans liked. Right? Because one thing that he didn't like was a proposal to unite the Fertile Crescent and to bring Syria and Iraq together. And Iraq was under the domination of the British. So that had happened. It would have been a wonderful advantage for Britain. And the Americans didn't want that. Because beneath all of these things we're talking about, all through the 20th century up to the present day, there are these subterranean tensions between these outside powers. I mean, there were between Britain and France in 1914 and 1918. They were wartime allies. Once the war was over, they were rivals, and the British did what they could to limit French gains. And why did the French leave Syria in 1946? Because the British put pressure on them, made them leave, because France was, relatively speaking, in a weak position. Britain was weak, but not as weak. And we see in the 1950s, Britain and United States, kind of this same subterranean tension playing out, because Britain's fading as an imperial power, America's moving into the region, and doesn't want the British to kind of regain lost ground. So this is all part of the picture.
Another bit of history,
going
back to those times, is that women were given the vote in Syria in 1949.
Mm-hmm.
And what disturbs me greatly is that we don't really know what Syrian society is like. Where
mm-hmm.
it's hidden
mm-hmm.
behind that mm-hmm. brutal dictator.
Mm-hmm.
So our media is presenting a brutal dictator versus rebels.
Mm-hmm.
And behind that brutal dictator,
mm-hmm.
you've got the army, a secular army,
mm-hmm.
and you've got a secular society, and mm-hmm. you've got women
mm-hmm.
that have extraordinary freedoms.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you think if we knew...
Yes, of course, if we knew. I mean, if people went there, I mean, Syria had, I think, quite a reasonable tourist
industry before this all broke out, and we all know that Syria is a fantastic country, wonderful place, right? So a number of people who go there are able to see that for themselves. But what the others have to rely on is what the media tell them, right? And the media doesn't tell them the things that you're saying. You know, and the media wasn't saying these things about many, many other countries. There's a kind of, the media will pick up a story, a narrative, which is fits in with what usually what a government wants, as it did over Iraq, as it's done in many, many other situations. You know, so Syria becomes a target to be destroyed. Therefore, it's not in the interest of the government or much of the media to talk about positive things about Syria. They're not going to talk about, you know, a secular society, freedom for women, all the rest, because then people are going to say, well, why are we attacking Syria? Why are we going for Syria? All right? And so the narrative over Syria has been shocking, absolutely shocking from the beginning. You know, there's been no balanced reporting whatsoever about Syria. You know, I mean, well, one or two reporters have filed reasonable reports from time to time, but 95-97% of the coverage has not conformed in any way to the standards of proper journalism. It's been completely biased, completely biased. You know, you haven't seen the other side. I mean, if you're a journalist, what is the prime responsibility is what they call balance. You know, you're never going to achieve perfect balance, but in a situation like this, even if you want to report what the rebels are saying and doing, and even if you and I don't think they really are rebels, but okay, let them have their say and let people think about it, but you have to report what the others are saying. You've got to go
the
to Syrian, you've got to go to the victims of the rebels. They're very good. The media for the last 5 years has talked about the victims of the Syrian army, as they say, all right, but they haven't paid any attention at all to the victims of these armed groups. And if they did, naturally, people would get a very, very different idea if they talked to the government, and if they, you know, if they were shown and were able to see what happens in families who've lost young men. I mean, how many young men have died in Syria fighting these groups? 60,000, something like that. Plus all the others, tens of thousands, have been wounded. And if that were shown, the whole narrative would be disrupted. But it can't be shown. It can't be shown. And you cannot really show the victims of wars, and this is common in all wars. They don't like to show the gruesome detail. I mean, we saw the other day, if I can just kind of digress a little bit, just yesterday Obama was wiping away tears for children who'd been shot dead in America. Well, this is the same Obama who's been ordering missile strikes in Yemen that have killed children. All right? Now, if you actually showed the victims of those missile strikes in Yemen, actually showed the victims, showed the bodies, well, then the American public would do a double take. Well, what on earth are we doing? Dead children. We're killing children in Yemen. No, you don't see those photographs. And the same in Syria. The same in Syria. You don't see the gory detail of what the armed groups are doing. It'll be played down. But then when the government does something or the military does something, it's magnified to the ultimate degree.
You know? And not
so
the context,
there can't be any trust left in the mainstream media at all now. There can't be. After Iraq, I thought Iraq was the absolute pinnacle of propaganda. Okay? Syria, the propaganda of Syria is even worse.